damos la bienvenida al doctor Joseph Michael.
Hello, my name is Joseph McHale. It's just an absolute pleasure to be a part of this symposium today. And I am been given the task of talking about where we have come from and where we're going in myeloma. So part of it is being a historian and part of it is actually looking into the future. And of course, you're going to have another excellent lecture afterwards, even going further into the novel treatments and opportunities that we have in multiple myeloma. So thank you again for inviting me and for sharing in this symposium with me. So my objectives that I'll cover over the next 20, 25 minutes are to discuss the ever-changing landscape of myeloma and how we are thinking about therapies and how important initial therapy is in the long-term benefit of a patient. We'll talk a little bit about how we approach relapse based on three major factors of patient disease and treatment characteristics. And then I'll focus much of my discussion on this trend that we're experiencing in myeloma, which is a very good and important one, which is really to be more aggressive in our earlier treatments for myeloma, as opposed to waiting and saving the best for later, because very often we won't be able to use them later, we use them earlier on. And then I'll focus in advance of the future of myeloma discussion, I'll be focusing a little bit more on three or four of the more recently approved agents, including selinexor, belantamab mafodotin, and melphalan flufenamide. So I always like to start with biology. So in the biology of this disease, we know that this is a disease that with time becomes more and more aggressive, that it becomes not only more chemo-resistant to what has been treated with, but it acquires more mutations and becomes, in that way, a form of clonal evolution, as we've described it before, where various different clones can vary in which one is the dominant clone, and very often the final clone is one that was barely existent at the start of a patient's diagnosis. The other thing to notice from this slide that is really important is that with each relapse, unfortunately, a patient's time in remission gets shorter and shorter. So this is one of the reasons why I was mentioning earlier, we don't save the best for last. Those first few remissions are going to be the deepest and the most durable. And so that's when we want to control the disease for as long as possible. Although we are developing great therapies in later line diseases, we're seeing we're quite likely to be bringing them earlier and earlier in the disease course. So what does this really mean clinically? Well, there's always been sort of two ways of thinking about myeloma. Do you think of myeloma as a disease we can cure or a disease we can control? In the cure camp, we give everything possible to cure the disease up front. Not sure that's really happened. In the control camp, we say, well, we'll treat it just like hypertension. Let's not be very aggressive and just try and hold the disease. Well, I think we agree that both extremes are not really correct. Balance is somewhere in the middle. But I will say that we have been tipping towards more of a cure-like approach. We've gone from doublets to triplets. We're quite likely moving into quadruplets, four drug combinations in frontline therapy. Sometimes I think of it as the 1-2 punch. What you give your patient, first-line therapy and second-line therapy together, think of that as a single treatment, if you will. That together is perhaps more prognostic than anything in the life of the patient. And so selecting those first few lines of therapy becomes so important and has resulted in us treating patients for longer. We're looking at deeper responses than we've ever seen, where we look potentially even at MRD negativity. And then the question comes, can we even replace stem cell transplant with something like CAR T cell therapy? But that's beyond the scope of the discussion today. The other pragmatic thing to remember is with each line of therapy, fewer and fewer patients are eligible for the treatment. Again, emphasizing the importance of what we do earlier in the disease course. So how do I approach relapse myeloma? Well, I don't have a simple algorithm. I don't just say I always do this and then I do this and then I do that. It's not that simple anymore. We have to really have a strategy. And whether it's early relapse, later relapse, or true triple class refractory, where I'll be focusing some of my discussion, we follow a few principles. Number one, depth of response really matters. We're not necessarily using MRD testing to guide our therapy yet, but the principle of getting into a very deep response becomes important. We have to respect that myeloma is many diseases in one. And sometimes with very high risk disease, we have to approach it a little bit differently. So we want to understand the difference between high risk and standard risk. And the third principle that I think is so important is to balance efficacy and toxicity, meaning, excuse me, if I'm going to treat a patient for a few months, we can understand certain toxicities, but if I'm going to treat patients for many, many months, I want to be very cognizant of its impact on their quality of life. And so it's important for us to assess that on a regular basis. Now, if I go to the US, the National Comprehensive Cancer Network guidelines, it's a huge list. And I recognize in Argentina and many other places, you don't have this kind of list, but this isn't really a guideline anymore. It's just a list of drugs. And so we need a strategy that helps us choose the right drugs for the right patient. So we wrote a paper a few years ago about this, where we talked about five big questions that you'd ask. Do I really need to treat this patient now? So some patients may be able to delay treatment a little bit if they're low risk and a very slow growing biochemical relapse, although we tend to treat more aggressively. Sometimes we retreat with what we've used before, not always our favorite in light of what I said about using our best therapies early on. Have I employed the big 12? Well, we have all these different classes of drugs now, immunomodulatory drugs, proteasome inhibitors, monoclonal antibodies, nuclear transport inhibitors, BCMA antibody drug conjugates, and now even a novel form of alkylation. These are all ones we have to consider when we're making a decision to treat a patient. And of course, more recently here in the US, we even have access to CAR T-cell therapy and likely have more access to that with time. Question number four, have I optimized the add-on agent? Sometimes we can appropriately lose steroids or other alkylators or some of these other drugs listed to be able to benefit our patient. And then lastly, excuse me, have I used a patient-driven risk stratified approach? Have I really thought it through, discussed it with my patient? You know, patient preferences become very important in what we do in myeloma so that we can individualize the treatment for that patient. So what are those three major factors I described? Disease-related, therapy-related, and patient-related. These are things that help us choose, am I going to go with this treatment or that treatment? What toxicity am I going to expect from this treatment versus that treatment? Is the patient high-risk disease or low-risk disease on the disease-related factors? Or for therapy, do I know that specific adverse events are likely going to happen with one therapy? Or patient-related factors, what comorbidities do they have? Do they have renal insufficiency? Do they prefer an oral regimen versus an IV regimen? All these things can influence our treatment selection. Lastly, before I go over some of the data of these new agents, I always like to say that myeloma is not one disease. We wish every patient were like this green line, where we treat them in induction therapy, they stay in remission for a long time, and they slowly biochemically relapse. But that's not the case. More often than not, it's like this, where people may get a deep relapse, but then a remission. But then when they relapse, unfortunately, each remission is a bit shorter. But then there's still that 25% of patients that have high-risk disease, where sadly, that first few times you have are so critical because the disease becomes very aggressive and it evolves in a way that is very difficult to control in the long term. So putting this all together, my principles of when I look to a patient who's relapsing and how I'm going to treat them, I follow three main principles. One, I use drugs with mechanisms of action that haven't been used yet. I want to come at the disease in a different angle. Number two, if the patient has been on lenalidomide, which many of our patients are for maintenance, I am not going to continue that lenalidomide if they're progressing. I want to, as I said, introduce a new mechanism of action. And when possible, in almost every situation, we want to use triplets instead of doublets because we've learned that those triplets can have a better control over the disease. So what does this mean in clinical practice? Well, not all of these agents are approved for you in Latin America or even in Europe, as is listed here. But we now have these five large trials that have recently read out to show to us the benefit of adding daratumumab to pomalidomide or isatuximab to pomalidomide, daratumumab to carfilzomib or isatuximab to carfilzomib, and even yet with selinexor, as I'll describe in a little bit, with bortezomib. So there are more options than we've ever had before. We have a lot of phase three data to support using these. As I mentioned, don't continue maintenance therapy, use a new mechanism of action, use a triplet. And then based on that patient disease and treatment characteristics chart, we can find what's best for the patient because there's no perfect sequence. So historically, as we divided people into transplant eligible and transplant ineligible, we would typically use a three-drug combination frontline, something like BRD or DRD. And then at relapse, if patients hadn't seen a CD38 antibody, we would use these regimens. And as you can see with time, we used other carfilzomib or pomalidomide-based therapies. And then at the triple class refractory are where I'm going to be focusing on in a few minutes. But looking to the future, we're likely going to change that. We're almost definitely moving to quadruplets up front. We may be bringing many of these newer therapies like CAR T-cell therapy and bispecific therapies and belantamab and others earlier into the disease course. So once a patient has become triple class refractory, what do? Well, historically, we often retreated with what we'd had before, which if that's what we have, that's what we have to do. Sometimes we gave patients a second transplant as long as they tolerated the first one, had a response to the first one, and importantly, had a duration of response of the first one of at least 18 months. Typically, we even want 2 or 3 years, knowing that a second transplant does not last as long as the first transplant. Sometimes we use salvage conventional chemotherapy, like DPACE chemotherapy or something very intense. We don't do it very often, but there may be some patients who could be eligible for an allo transplant if they're particularly young and may have a donor, and we really have run out of other options. Sometimes in very specific forms of myeloma, like in translocation 11-14, we may consider venetoclax or a clinical trial. So up until recently, this was most of what we had as an option once someone became triple class refractory to immunomodulatory drugs, proteasome inhibitors, and monoclonal antibodies. Well, that's changing now because now we have many more options, including these three new agents that we've seen over the last year, and indeed now with CAR T-cell therapy and likely much more with CAR T-cell therapy coming. So let me start with selinexor. So what is selinexor? Well, it's a first-in-class XPO1 inhibitor. Basically, we have good tumor suppressors in our nucleus. We want them to stay there, because then the cell lives its normal life and then dies. But one of the mechanisms of cancer is to get rid of those tumor suppressors out of the nucleus so that the cell can become malignant and live forever. And it pushes those out through the exportin-1 or XPO1 pathway. And this is a drug, selinexor, that blocks that. So things like P53 can stay in the cell. It was proven in very heavily relapsed patients, even those who were penta-refractory, so all five major drugs they had been resistant to. And we saw a response rate of about 25-26%. So quite impressive in that heavily pretreated a population with a median duration of response of about 4 months. More recently, we've even brought selinexor earlier into the disease course in 1 to 3 prior lines. When we now give it weekly, we found, by the way, it is much better tolerated because of the GI toxicity and the nausea, for example, when we give it weekly. We're also given the bortezomib weekly. And so the Boston study was a phase 3 study comparing XVD or selinexor bortezomib dexamethasone versus bortezomib dexamethasone, showing about a 4.5 month improvement in progression-free survival. So when we do treat with this drug, I must say that there it causes cytopenias, it can cause this fatigue or anorexia, it can cause true nausea, and in some cases, not so much now as we use it weekly, cause hyponatremia. So it's important, we can manage these because many people have abandoned this drug without giving it a chance. But I use olanzapine and a 5-HT3 antagonist, anti-nauseant in all of my patients and found it's much more manageable. Now, what about BCMA? Everybody seems to be talking about BCMA these days, or B-cell maturation antigen. This is found on the surface of our malignant plasma cells. It's not as heavily expressed in early precursor B cells. And BCMA has a lot of activities that have to do with B cell growth and survival, as you can see here. And so it's very much a natural target because it's present and because it's involved in cell cycle modulation. So the first BCMA targeted agent we have is belantamab mafodotin. As you may know, this is an antibody drug conjugate. So it's an antibody directed against BCMA, but it has attached to it a toxin, the mafodotin, that can be dropped into the cell and help cause cell death. The basis of this was the DREAM-2 study, which compared two different doses of belantamab mafodotin. Ultimately, going ahead with the lower dose, we saw that in this, again, heavily pretreated population, we had a 31% single agent response rate, which is about as good as we've ever seen in myeloma. Not to mention that over half of them had achieved at least a very good partial remission. Generally speaking, with regards to the hematological toxicities, infusion reactions, it's really quite well managed. However, nearly three quarters of patients experience ocular toxicity, primarily in the form of keratopathy. We're still trying to understand the full nature of this. We think it has to do with the toxin accumulating in the cornea, but people can get vision changes with decreased visual acuity, dry eyes, a blurred vision as a result of it. So here in the States, we have what's called a REMS program, where indeed we have to have patients followed very meticulously for this, and they have to see an eye specialist before each dose that they're given. So my view on this is the first BCMA-directed therapy in myeloma, very impressive response rates, but this corneal toxicity is an issue. We really have to understand this better and likely have to change our dosing strategy for patients. That being said, it's very easily given IV, at least now once every 3 weeks, over 30 minutes, and there isn't a risk of cytokine release syndrome like we see with a lot of other agents. So in that way, it's easy to administer in the community. Now, for many years, we've known about melphalan. We've used melphalan and transplant for many, many years, 40 years now. But more recently, we have a peptide drug conjugate. So this is melphalan flufenamide. So the melphalan is conjugated to a peptide that when together are lipophilic, which means it can make it into the cell quite easily. When in the cell, that bond is broken by virtue of the aminopeptidases that are in excess in cancer cells, in particular myeloma cells. So now this releases the alkylator, the melphalan as it were, and now that it's hydrophilic, it wants to stay within the cell and head into the nucleus. And so basically it's a way of directing the alkylator payload directly to the nucleus instead of the very high dose melphalan that we use in the context of stem cell transplant. This was explored in the HORIZON study. And we look at about 100 patients that had four prior lines of therapy, including refractoriness to each of the three major classes. Again, we saw about a 24% response rate lasting about 4 months. And these were quite heavily pretreated patients. Now, this drug is given quite easily, over 30 minutes once a month, but it does require a central line. And now I would suggest with less and less use of oral melphalan, especially in transplant ineligible patients, this could be a very legitimate option. So someone might say to me, well, how do I choose between selinexor or belantamab and melphalan flufenamide? Which is a really important question because every day in my clinic, people come in with triple class refractory disease and we talk through all of these options. And now we're going to add CAR T cell to it in just a moment. There's no perfect strategy, but I think it's important to make a distinction between these treatments, partly based on toxicity. How concerning could a keratopathy be, maybe to someone who's driving every day compared to someone else who may not be? How prone is the patient to nausea or anorexia when it comes to selinexor? Is getting a central line a problem? So they're all legitimate strategies, but we have to look at the toxicities associated with it. What's the patient preference? Have they recently had alkylator therapy? I do suspect that many of our patients will end up seeing more than one of these classes of drugs nonetheless. So looking into the future, what are the emerging therapies in myeloma? We have so many more things. CAR T-cell therapy, which has really shown to us unprecedented response rates, where now we're doing them auto. We take a patient's T-cells and manufacture them and give them back to them, but maybe someday we can do it allo. Maybe we can just take T-cells off the shelf and give them to patients. Bispecific therapies, you can try specific therapies that will leverage a local T cell or maybe even a local natural killer cell, not just using BCMA, but using these two new targets we've now developed with GPRC5D and FCRH5. Not to mention other novel agents are being developed like iberdomide, which is a new cell mod, or if you will, a next generation immunomodulatory drug. So for now in myeloma, we have proteasome inhibitors, immunomodulatory drugs, monoclonal antibodies and alkylators. We've recently added these three new pillars of selinexor, belantamab mafodotin, and just recently CAR T-cell therapy. And who knows, before long, we might be adding bispecific T-cell engagers or even natural killer cell engagers. It's always a delight to be participating in the world of myeloma, and in particular in Latin America. As many of you know, I have a very sensitive spot for the work that we do in Latin America, including Argentina, where we've recently created the Latin American Myeloma Network, where we're seeking to find ways to increase access to agents, clinical trials for Latin American patients who currently don't have access to these things. So I hope this has been helpful to you. I trust that you've seen the strategy we take now of using our best therapies up front, but now we have more options than ever before for triple class refractory disease. And we're going to even have more options as we develop more, as you're going to hear shortly, from CAR T-cell therapies and bispecifics and other immunotherapies. Thank you so much for your attention.